Best coach in MMA. I mean, he works. I'm with him 6 days a week, twice a day, working. But it's just like mentally, he keeps me so relaxed and focused, which I'm very thankful for. Just like, I can't really explain it. Just he's a great mentor for me. Talks to me. We train. It's just a good little. We click very, very well.
Have you guys talked about what's potentially next for you and any opponents you guys might be interested in fighting?
No, we haven't really talked about that, but we've already talked about what we need to do to get better. And as we were waiting for this, we were talking about our strategies for the future as far as getting better, working on lateral movements, certain things that we need to continue to grow as fighters. So,
what else? Just besides lateral movement, what else? Tell us, give us all the good details.
No, I can't. I'll save it for my next fight.
All right, brother. Good job tonight.
Thanks, guys.
Hey, Eric. Right here.
Yeah.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Can you compare the knockout punches Justin Lin to the jaw versus this one tonight?
I'm sorry, say that again?
Can you compare the knockout punches Justin Lin versus this one?
For me, they're both really, really great, but I like this because I'm in front of my home, in front of my friends and family. The Justin Lin knockout was really good for me. I don't know, it's just, anytime you get a knockout, it's just a good feeling, for sure.
And then I noticed you were ringside for Joey Davis's fight.
Yeah.
What was that like watching that spinning kick knocked out? Did it inspire you, motivate you?
He lands that in practice on me, and I know I feel for the guy, because I think it's deadly, so I'm happy it wasn't on me, he's using it in the fight, because every time I go with him, I'm always kind of like, it's something that he throws all the time, and if it lands, it knocks the wind out of me, because he's landed on me plenty of times. And so when Ian Butler went down, I'm like, I feel for you, because that thing is deadly, because like I said, I've taken it before by joke.
Can you explain a little bit, my last question, what you guys have going on there at the body shop with yourself and AJ McKee, Joey Davis, under Antonio McKee?
Yeah, I think we just all have different styles. We all have different personalities, but at the end of the day, it all fits well. It just molds well, and we have a great leader. That's Antonio. He structures practice the way we need to. That's his life. Is making us the best fighters in the world. And if you just show up and you come with your work boots on and give everything you possibly have, Antonio is there for you. We have a great group of guys that all. Have different styles, all have personalities, like I said. At the end of the day, we all hold each other accountable that we're going to be there at practice, and we show up to work, and we have something very, very special going on at the body shop.
Aaron, right here. That's three fights for you in 7 months. I'm curious, would you prefer to make another quick turnaround, or would you like some time off before the next fight?
I hope I fight soon. I mean, I'm healthy. And like I said, time is my friend. I need as much time as I can in the cage, and this is what I love to do. I'm healthy. I make good money. I mean, what else can I ask for? I've got a good life, so I want to keep fighting. I'm very thankful, and this is my job. I sincerely love my job, so anytime I can get back in the cage, I'm for it.
7 months ago, you learned a pretty tough lesson in your first fight, and since then, you know, two straight knockouts, it's been pretty impressive. What did you, you know, looking back on it, what's the biggest thing you learned with that fight at Madison Square Garden that's helped you in the most recent two fights?
Yeah, for me, I mean, one is just the weight. I was up in weight, I won 55, and there's so many things that you can possibly say, but I just think the biggest thing was just, you know, it's just not relaxing. I mean, I just needed to just take my time. But everything happens for a reason. There's so much positives came out of that loss that I'm actually very, very thankful for the loss. Like, I'm super, super thankful that I lost Madison Square Garden. I think it sounds kind of funny to say, but if I wouldn't have lost, I wouldn't have been with Antonio. I wouldn't have been at the body shop. I probably wouldn't be training with Freddie Roach. Just so many things lined up for me that I'm super thankful for the loss in Madison Square Garden. But I'm right on track.
Aaron, your body shop relationship, how are you balancing Aaron Antonio McKee as a trainer versus a father? Because his kid's in the gym, same weight class. You guys have an agreement that you will or won't fight each other? What's the dynamic there?
No, we've already talked about it. AJ and I won't fight. That's just a given. I mean, AJ McKee and I have been friends since we were little kids. He used to be out of the house all the time, spending the night over for barbecues on family trips with us. So, no, that's just weird. There's many people in the world to beat up rather than us fighting. It's just not going to happen. So
AJ has designs on winning the title. He wants to be champion. Obviously, you do too. If he has that belt, are you going to stay at 45 or are you going to go back up to 55?
Well, there's things that we've talked about and discussed, but I can't say it now. But bottom line is that we're not going to fight. But we've had that discussion. It's not going to happen.
Okay, so your regular training partners. What does he bring you? What's the best thing that AJ does for you?
Everything. I mean, he's a problem. He's funky on the feet. Throws all these kicks. On the ground, he can submit you. I mean, it's just two different styles. What I have with boxing, the wrestling, him is just the overall MMA, the flying kicks, the spinning elbows. It's just great. I haven't seen that. I've been wrestling for the past couple of years, just nonstop. So, perfect training partners for each other.
Yes, what's up, guys? Thank you guys so much for coming out. Recap of the night, man. Goichi Yamauchi is a very, very, very tough individual. He had me a little bit puzzled on the feet. He's longer and rangier than I thought. We expected that, but we were able to land some good stuff. Coaches were great in the corner. Coaches were coaching me up exactly how we practice in camp to mitigate that distance. And then on the ground, you saw what happened. So it was great. I think it's been hard for me to get up for certain fights when there's not danger involved, and Goichi definitely presented a large test on the ground, and we went out there and shut him down and did a good job on the ground. So just want to thank my coaches, thank my training partners, thank my family and all y'all for coming out. Phenomenal night, so thank you guys so much. Any questions?
Yeah, Mike, as you said, I mean, it ended up being a very dominant win for you, but it certainly wasn't easy along the way. So, I mean, can you talk about maybe any adjustments you had to make? And overall, are you satisfied with how you performed in the end?
Yeah, I am, actually. I was just telling somebody over there, since they changed the scoring and now they're more liberal with the 10-8s and the 10-7s, you know, I was very jealous a couple months ago. I saw somebody get some 10, some 30-25s and 30-26s, and I was like, dang, I want to do that. So whenever we were reading the scorecards, I was actually extremely, extremely happy. It almost was more satisfying than if I would have TKO'd him, you know, to have those scorecards and people could look it up and see. But yeah, I mean, I'm satisfied. My knees hurt like heck because they're freaking, they're raw from just being on top and doing damage. But like I said, he is tough. I mean, we're all so tough at this level, and like I said, he presented some very good tests, distance-wise, speed, tenacity. He was talking to me in there. I was talking to him. He was taunting me. I was taunting him. It was fun. I can honestly say I actually had a blast tonight, and I don't usually do that. A lot of times I black out, go Michael Chandler style, 100,000 miles an hour. Sometimes I win, sometimes I lose, but tonight was a lot of fun, and great crowd. We're on CMT and Paramount Network, so it was just awesome card all together, and I feel extremely blessed.
I was going to ask you about the conversations. We can see you mouthing to each other in there. What were those conversations like? What was being said?
Yeah, it was just, you know, he would kick me. Like, he knew he hit me with a hard knee to the body, and he kind of gave me the whole, like, ooh, that hurt, you know, and I hit him with the right hand. I was stalking him, like, come on, where are you going, you know, because he did a very good job of evading, man. It's not many guys will come forward on me and fight me on my terms because they know they're going to get knocked out or finished. So a lot of guys have to circle, they have to move, they have to use their footwork, they have to use their distance. He was doing a great job of that. He's an extremely talented young man. When I say young man, young in age, but experienced in the fight game. He's got more fights than I do. So we're going to see a lot from him coming forward. And I also said after the fight, man, I'm probably going to see you again. You know, let's do it again. Work on that ground game.
Nice. And last thing for me, I mean, you made it clear before the fight, title fight's not really what you're thinking about. So I want to ask you first, I mean, is that because of your personal feelings for the champ? And second, what fights are out there? You said big fights, but are there specific names? Are there matchups that you see right now that you think would be more marketable and bigger and more important for you?
Well, let's call a spade, man. I've been with this organization now for 8-9 years. I've helped grow this company, and this company has done a phenomenal job of growing me. It's been a phenomenal symbiotic relationship since ESPN Deportes days to MTV2 to where to Spike and now to Paramount and CMT simulcast. And I have such a great relationship with these guys that have done such great things for me. I take pride in being the Bellator champion. I never wanted to discredit what the Bellator championship has meant to me and what the belts at my house meant to me. But you know, I wanted the rematch. You know, 10 days after 10 days after Madison Square Garden, I ran 5 miles. And I said, book the rematch. I was talking to the guys. And, you know, the so-called champion was not ready. And you know, he was on maternity leave, and just so happens I adopted a child, and I moved all the way across the country, and I built a house, and I had a lot of stuff going on. We are professionals, and we are men, and it's time to step into the cage and put the belt on the line. And he wasn't willing to do that, so yeah, there was a little bit of distaste in my mouth, or a little bit of a bad taste in my mouth for that situation. But there are some big fights. Patricio Pitbull is calling me out on social media. I didn't respond because obviously I had this going on. The Paul Daly fight. I mean, there's some fights out there, but at the end of the day, I have a ton of respect for Scott Coker and what he has done for Strikeforce back in the day, and what he has done since day one, since he stepped foot into this Bellator realm. And let's be honest, I'll do what I'm told, and I will do it in a dominant fashion. So we'll see what happens. We'll have some conversation and see what happens.
Congratulations, Michael. Very much the performance of the night. Well, I know it's still going on, but it was what we saw. During a fighter's career, I mean, obviously one of the things you're very popular for with fans is this kind of old school mentality you've got when you step into the fighting arena. But tonight, perhaps, and during a fighter's career, we see shifts sometimes, paradigm shifts, where they develop the style they want. Is it fair to say tonight we saw that old school style from you, but you really used your fighting IQ?
Yeah, I mean, I think there was a little bit of both. I think I wasn't having as much success as I wanted to on the feet, and I had an extreme amount of success in that first round on the ground, and it was easy for me. Not to say it was easy, not to discredit the Tuichi, but it was easy for me. There's not a man on this earth that could be underneath me and not get demolished. And I know that about myself because I've done it in the cage, I've done it in the gym. And just because he's finished 18 fights by armbar, rear naked choke, triangle, it did not deter me from getting back to my wrestling roots, realizing that I'm a dominant man on the ground and on the feet. But I knew that I was going to be able to take this fight to the ground. And I saw his tape. He has more success on, if he doesn't get a submission, he has more success on his feet than he does on the ground. And I thought the easiest path to dominance was going to be able to beat him up on the feet as much as I could, keep him at bay as long as I could so I could get the shot, and then rain down Firestorm of elbows.
And finally for me, how long did it take till after the fight, or maybe you thought about it during the fight, to think about your son?
Man, the funny thing was, you know, I mean, and luckily this affected me very well, but right before the fight, literally right before the referee said, are you ready? There was a picture of Hap on my shoulders in the arena, and I got the biggest smile on my face, and it's an absolute amazing feeling now, not just fighting. When I got into the sport, I fought for myself and for my legacy and for my mom and dad who just pulled themselves up by their bootstraps for the whole 20-something years and gave me every opportunity that I possibly could. But now to have them, and now have a wife, and now have someone that literally is gonna hang on my every breath for the rest of my life, and someone to lead and someone to love. It's absolutely the most ridiculous feeling I've ever felt in my entire life. My heart is literally bursting at the seams, and I cannot wait to get back and kiss his little cheeks. But at that moment, I smiled like crazy. I looked over at Bree, she wasn't looking at me. You know, she was in her tents, scared to death. My son's about to get into a fight in the cage. But I looked over at her, and it was amazing. And right after, the first thing I thought about was getting back home to him. And it's my life has a new purpose, and God has blessed me so much, and I'm just excited about
brilliant,
life.
Brilliant. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah, Grandma.
Last one up here. congratulations. I got a live stream and a fan asked me if you're willing to move up to 170.
I've said that I'm willing to move up to 170. You know, it's gotta be the right fight. We'll find out what California says after this. I think I was a little bit overweight for their, you know, weight check thing. So we'll see what happens. But I'm a big 155er. The only reason I can make 155 is that there's not a man alive that's more disciplined than I am. For 8 weeks, I forego every single thing that I want to, nutrition-wise, drinking-wise. And I put my body through a living hell on earth to make sure that I get my body fat down. I keep my muscle, my lean muscle. I can push out the water at the end. And that's why I've always made 155, because I'm disciplined. If I wanted to enjoy my life, 170 would be a phenomenal weight class for me. So we will see. Obviously, like I said, man, I'm a company guy. I've always done what's best for myself, but also in relation to Ballator. And we'll see what happens. We'll talk to Scott, and we'll see. I definitely would entertain it, and there's some interesting fights at 170. So,
just speaking of 170, just want to get your reaction to what happened to Rory and that leg kick and all that.
That was messed up, man. Gosh, I was back there. I was watching, and that swelling is a little bit scary. I don't know. I know he's on his way to the hospital. I don't know if it's a broken leg. You're in like compartment syndrome zone looking at that, you know? So I hope he's okay, hope everything's going good. But man, Lima, those two put on a phenomenal show. Those are two of the best welterweights on the planet that just slugged it out for us tonight. Put on a great show. I honestly didn't know who was gonna win the fight going into it. I didn't know who was gonna win the fight going into the fifth. Great fight, great show of heart by both guys. And just like Bellator always does, Bellator fashion, put on phenomenal fights for the fans. Right here, kicking off on the Paramount Network.
Thank you. Really appreciate it. What a fantastic night. Just want to thank not just you guys, but all these people who came out, including our great partners here at the Forum. What an incredible way to start the Paramount Network and the start of the Heavyweight Grand Prix. It's our first fight of 2018. What better way to start here at the Forum, where I live, where I grew up. I saw a lot of home games here, from Lakers, Kings. So it's a real special place for me to come here and celebrate the start of our new network. And the start of this Heavyweight Grand Prix is fantastic. Great fights tonight in front of a packed house. We really couldn't be happier about the way it went. Everybody had a great time. The energy level in the house was amazing, and I just feel like we have really something really special, really big here with the start with this Heavyweight Grand Prix. I think you saw some of the entertainment elements that we put together for the Heavyweight Grand Prix, and I think that's just the start of what you'll see throughout 2018. So, and it's all because of this man right here, Scott Coker, who has brought this amazing event to life here. So, that's it.
Thanks, John. I just want to say a couple of things. I've seen a lot of fights in my day, and I've seen a lot of warriors go in there and do it, man. But Roy McDonald really impressed me. And he had the perseverance, indomitable spirit, all the, you know, the intangibles of, you know, what I consider the foundation of martial arts. And he exemplified some great strength tonight, inner strength that, you know, he could have quit a couple times. Like, that leg was gone. It was done. I was telling Rich, I go, Rich, I think his leg is done. I don't think he can even walk. And I said, one more kick, it's over. And then he got kicked again, and they took him right down. I was like, wow, this guy wants it really bad. So to me, that was an amazing performance. Douglas Lima, he showed why he was the champ. It was a great fight. And, you know, who knows, maybe they'll get it together again, you know, one day. I look at Aaron Pico's performance. Wow, I mean, it's that kid. You know, what I saw tonight is why we signed him 3 years ago when he was just 18 years old. And we invested a lot of time and efforts and resources into him and helped him build his knowledge and his career past just wrestling. And he's delivered it the last two times, and we're expecting great things from him. And, you know, Chael. Listen, Chael, you know, if you were to tell me that Chael was going to try to kickbox Rampage for the first full round, I would not believe it. But you know, he had a strategy and he was picking at him, and now he gets to fight the winner of Fedor versus Frank Mir. So we're looking forward to the semifinals with Chael and overall great night of fights. Michael had a dangerous fight. He came out and did what he does, and you know, he looked great. So all in all, I thought we had a great night of fights, and it was, like John said, it was electric in there, and I just had a good time sitting back and watching it and enjoying the fights as a fan. Thank you.
First question is for John. John, during the Corrales-Karkanian fight, there was an audible buzz going on in the arena. Do you know what that was and if that affected the broadcast at all, or was it just in the arena?
No, they said they didn't hear that in the truck. Well, we heard it too. Obviously, some sort of audio issue, but they were on it and it was fixed. But to my knowledge, I talked to people in the truck; they could not hear from the truck. So hopefully, it didn't affect the broadcast.
And then for Scott, you know, we've seen some sort of creative shuffling of the deck this week. I'm curious, is it definite that Chael will fight the winner of Fedor and Mir, or after the first round, is it possible when you see the metrics and the numbers that there may be a reseeding of the tournament at a certain point?
Yeah, I think the pairings are matched up properly, and a lot of it was timing. Like when Frank Mir was going to be ready to fight, when Fedor was going to fight. Fedor had a little bit of a nasal passage surgery that he had in December, so he couldn't fight, you know, in January. We wanted him to fight here in LA, actually, and he wasn't available. So, you know, I think the pairings are great. I think it's going to be really entertaining, and I'm really excited about the year-long storyline and, you know, hosting this tournament.
And just the last one, you know, tonight was a big night, not just for you guys, but for MMA in general. There was another event that went on. The UFC has already announced their schedule coming up for the next couple months, and you guys have sort of kept your schedule a little bit, you know, tucked in the pocket. It seemed like they sort of stacked their deck today to compete with you guys. Is it possible, knowing their dates in the future, that you may also try and do the same against them?
You know, my belief is, you know, we had to do this fight on this day because it's a launch of Paramount Network, which was amazing. I love the new graphics package. I love the whole thing. It looked really, really great. And if you guys saw the sizzle reel of what the Paramount Network is gonna do, what type of entertainment it's gonna, you know, have on this network, it's amazing. And if you don't have the sizzle reel, please get a hold of it. And we didn't have very many options. We had to do it on this weekend. We could have done it on Friday or we could have done it on Saturday, but the forum was available tonight because they had a concert last night. We wanted to do it here in LA, where, you know, my account was launching Paramount, so it ended up here. I believe that, look, no one's targeting each other's days. It doesn't help them for us to have a fight like this on a pay-per-view night when you can watch it for free on Paramount. There's no way that that's going to be a great business model for anybody. But I also believe that we both have businesses to run, right? And we're not targeting their dates. They're not targeting our dates. They're doing their business and we're doing our business, and that's how I look at it.
This is questions for Scott and John. So 2018, I mean, you guys got the ball rolling and a lot of changes. Since you took over Ballator, you've had a lot of new fighters, even changes in the broadcasting. Can you talk about, in terms of how you see kind of your overall, you got the ball rolling now, and how you feel like this whole Ballator, you know, new age of Ballator is moving forward and it's looking very promising. Also, a two-parter, in terms of the numbers tonight, how do you see that tonight trending?
Yeah, a couple quick things. First of all, it does feel like a new beginning. I think with a new network, maybe, you know, new people on the broadcast team, Jay Glazer, Big John McCarthy were fantastic. I don't know if you got to hear Big John, but it's hard to believe that this was his first time in a long, 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 long time ever doing anything like this. So that was very impressive. I think the feedback I've heard has been fantastic. So on the broadcast side, it feels new. As we said, new graphics package, new network, new members of the broadcast team. and our new heavyweight tournament. So it is a new start for us, and I feel like we're off to an amazing start. Look at the people in the building. So I think it's great. Now, as far as the numbers tonight, obviously, you know, I make a rule never to talk about numbers and try to make predictions, but I will break that rule tonight by saying that this will be, without a doubt, the highest rating in the history of the Paramount Network. I do a little stand up on the side, it's the coolest thing I do.
I just throw something in there. I think today is our second biggest attendance in the history of this company since I've been here. And 3 years ago, when I came to Ballator, you know, it was a much different look and feel and what they're trying to accomplish, and we changed that. And I think that, you know, when you see fights like this, or, you know, when you see the fight that we did last year here at this time, or the Madison Square Garden fight, it's a completely different company. And like John said today, it's like a rebirth, because new broadcast team, new graphics. I love the graphics package. And listen, John McCarthy, I saw him do his commentary when Affliction had their shows way back, like 10 years ago. And I listened to him, and he did Fedor versus Tim Sylvia, and then another man, Fedor versus Andre Arlovski. And I said, John is amazing. This guy should be in the broadcast field. And he always wanted to do it. He's been bugging me for a year. A year ago, we sat down, and he was like, I really want to make the transition. And I think I've done everything I can do in refereeing. But my passion and my goal really is to spend the next, you know, 10, 15 years being in the broadcast booth. And so it just worked out that, you know, we had somebody who couldn't finalize a bunch of deal, we couldn't finalize this deal. And we moved on, and John is amazing. Jay Glazer is amazing. I think he brings a lot to the table. And so I think we have the best broadcast team in the business right now.
John, with the rebranding, or actually the new launch of Paramount, and in 48 hours everything that shifted, is Ballator going to be part of the major foundation of Paramount Network? Just same way with Lip Sync Battle was on its launch with the Michael Jackson thing. And how is that going to affect the demographics? Because Spike was primarily a male-oriented channel. And for Scott, you know, every year keeps getting better and better, and we're excited with it. With the next phase of the Grand Prix and following that, is there a possible cruiserweight division being created, since most of the heavyweights are between 220 and 255?
Yeah, well, Ballator is a cornerstone of the Paramount Network. Viacom's really proud to have it in this portfolio, and we're going to continue to support it. And essentially what this has done is given the home of Ballator a broader and bigger network to put its shows on. So essentially, this is a great thing for Ballator. As far as the demographics go, I think more people will be exposed to Ballator than ever before as a result of Paramount's expanding and broadening demographics. So I think it's a positive thing. I think it's a win-win. So, of course, you're going to see the same kind of high-quality MMA action that you've always seen on Spike, but now it's going to be exposed to a bigger and broader audience, and that's going to be nothing but good for everybody.
Could you repeat the second part of that question one more time? Sorry.
I was asking, with a lot of the heavyweights being on the lower end of the scale, will there possibly be a cruiserweight division created for the fighters that are within the 220 to 240 range?
You know, right now there is no discussion of that, but it's something that, you know, that we should talk about. But I will say this, Ryan Bader fights at 205, but he is a big light heavyweight. King Mo has proven he can fight in heavyweight or light heavyweight. And, you know, people that, you know, criticize Chael for moving up, that he's just a middleweight or he's just like, listen, if you weigh over 205, you're a heavyweight. And that's the rules of MMA. And so, look what happened tonight. You know, Chael was dancing and moving and sticking and gave Rampage a hard time to land anything on him. And, you know, I think that his speed and his agility helped him in the weight class and didn't hurt him. So, there is a dialogue, but it's certainly something that we would consider in the future.
Thank you.
Question for Scott. You said during the week that you were waiting to make an announcement in terms of alternates and other possible participants. We are finally at the end of night one. Are you ready to make any announcements in terms of who could be participating as an alternate?
Yes, I was hoping you would forget and not ask that question, but...
Sorry.
No, I have an answer, actually. We have a couple fighters that we're going to invite into as our first round of alternates because, as you know, things could happen in the tournament. The last tournament I threw, it was the third alternate fighter that ended up winning the whole thing in great fashion. And he won tonight, so congratulations. Chet Congo is somebody we're going to invite into the tournament, and Javier Ayala, who had a really great fight with Roy Nelson. Both those heavyweights will be invited to come in and participate as alternates.
Scott, do you have an update on Rory? Was he transported to the hospital? And what's the, give me an idea what the leg injury is.
Yeah, you know what? Honestly, Josh, I don't know. I know he did go to the hospital. And you know, he took a lot of damage tonight, so I'm glad that he's there getting checked out thoroughly. He's had a lot of damage to his legs. You know, he took a lot of shots to the face. I mean, you know, the guy was in a war tonight. And I'm glad he's there getting checked out and making sure he's okay.
Do you think he answered the call? People were wondering about him coming off the Lawler fight and coming into Bellator, off the damage that he had, getting the nose reconstruction and everything. Do you think he's answered those criticisms about him or concerns about him and whether he can carry on later into his career?
Yeah, I mean, I think that, you know, time will tell because, you know, he took some shots tonight and I'm not sure, you know, if that nose is broken or it's just, you know, a bloody nose. But when he gets back from the hospital, we'll definitely have a conversation and see where he's at.
And one more for me. Do you just see it taking him to Canada? Have you had discussions about that? Is that the natural evolution where you would take Rory McDonald?
Yeah, Rory is our welterweight champion. I think that we have the best welterweight division on the planet, and I think that Rory's next fight should be in Canada, fighting in his country.
Yes.
Good evening. Can I ask you, first of all, Scott, how did you score Rory McDonald and Douglas Lima?
You know, Gareth, honestly, I didn't score it. I just sat back and watched it as a fan. And I didn't write down any notes. I didn't take any mental notes. It was, you know, at one point, when Lima hurt him, I thought it was going to be over. I thought, a couple more kicks, you know, I've seen it. It's over. And, you know, when Rory's leg started swelling up, I was like, he's done. And it's only been he dug in deep. You know, he wanted that belt, and you know, he wanted the fight, so it worked out for him.
For both of you, for John and for Scott, clearly you needed to stage the narrative, the launch of the Bellator heavyweight division on that tournament on Paramount with those fighters coming on, you know, the other six fighters coming into the fighting arena and Rampage and Chael then coming in. Were you happy with the way that played out after the title fight and that the momentum of that fight in the night was satisfying the way it flowed for both of you?
I thought it was great. I think it's, what I really like about it is it feels like a separate event. It feels like we're really starting something. We reset, the house goes to black, bring in the fighters, do the national anthem. It really feels like we're starting a new event, and that's exactly what we tried to do because we wanted this to feel separate from what we were doing before. For a lot of reasons. There's a lot of good business reasons why we're doing that. Because we want to be able to think of it as a separate thing. So I think we accomplished that. So yeah, it felt great.
Thank you. Do you feel like that was the promoter as well?
Yeah, I mean, you know, to me it's like I enjoyed both those fights, Gareth. And honestly I can sit back and watch them both and enjoy it. And you know, the order that it went down in, I thought it was fine. I mean, you know, Rampage is still a big star. Rory's a big star. You know, Chael's a big star. I mean, it's, you know, these are stars of our sport.
Well, the only thing I think was missing, I think the arena would have gone ballistic if Rampage had knocked Chael out. You know, rather than loping up the slope just now and off into the night to thank his fans for following him, you know.
I tell you, with Rampage, any one shot could have ended the night. And he just didn't catch him. It was Chael's night tonight.
Let me congratulate you both on a great show tonight, very enjoyable, some great fights. Scott, I had a question for you. happened here, Shaq Congo was an alternate for the heavyweight Grand Prix. Since he was on a five-fight win streak in the heavyweight division, I'm just curious. I spoke to him tonight. He didn't have an answer. I was curious why he wasn't included in the original.
Why he wasn't included in the original tournament?
Yes.
Yeah, because he and Rampage are good friends and training partners, and the decision was not to put him in the tournament because of their relationship.
Sky, just to clarify real quick, Congo and Ayala, will they fight each other? Is that how that'll work?
You know what? That has not been determined yet, John. We're gonna reserve like comment on that, but only because we'll probably be announcing two more heavyweights that we'll invite this coming week, and then you know we might shuffle the deck, but we'll let you know soon.
Got it. I think there was a graphic on tonight's broadcast that Frank Mir and Fedor will fight April 28th in Chicago. Is that right? That hadn't been announced. I just wanted to confirm that with you. That wasn't a mistake or anything like
yes,
that.
Yes, April 28th in Chicago at the Allstate Arena. Fedor will fight Frank Mir as the main event of the tournament.
Any other bouts for that card yet?
Pardon me?
Are there any other bouts for that card yet?
No, that's just the main event. And then May 12th in San Jose, we're going to have the Kingmo versus Vader fight.
Fantastic. Just two more quick ones for me. We saw Cyborg, Chris Cyborg, walking around tonight. She had said earlier this week, she's saying she may need to come to Bellator because to prove that she's the best featherweight in the world, because you have a more robust featherweight division. I'm just curious if you saw those comments and if that's something that maybe appeals to you at some point.
You know, that somebody brought that to my attention tonight, actually, and she had just texted me and said, hey, I want to come. She's, you know, lives in L.A. She's always welcome to any of our fights that we do. You know, she's a... been around. She's you know, a legend. She's a pioneer in the female fighting for MMA, and you know, she used to fight for me before, so we always had a good relationship. She wanted to go to the fights, and it was really that simple. It was just she wanted to go to the fights. I said, yeah, come over. And then she did text me one thing before she left. She said, stop taking all the girls. So I just laughed. I mean, listen, she's under contract. We're not going to interfere with anybody's contract, and you know, we have plenty of fighters that we're booking and you know, fighting, and we have our hands full of this tournament. So, to me, it was just, you know, tongue in cheek.
Fantastic. Just last thing for me. Earlier tonight, Michael Chandler brought up Paul Daly. Paul Daly kind of had some negative things to say this week. He was upset that you were talking about MVP and all that. So I'm curious, you know, if you had a chance to talk to Paul Daly, where that stands, and, you know, just kind of how your relationship is with him right now.
You know, I'll tell you, it's really interesting because when I think of Paul Daly, I think of one of the, you know, most entertaining fighters I've ever been around. Some of the best fights in the history of my promotion was with Paul Daly. And I love his fighting style. I've always loved him. And when I came back to Bellator, he was one of the first guys that reached out to Patch. But Paul's very emotional, you know? And Paul is Paul. So I don't take it personally. He's saying what he's saying. You know, to me, hey, he's the one that called out MVP, right? He fought Roy, didn't work out. He comes after MVP, he calls MVP out. So we said, so I'm thinking, all right, we're gonna do this fight. And then the next thing he's like, I changed my mind. I'm like, okay, listen, whatever. So, you know, we'll figure out with Paul, but listen, I think he's just making motion right now, and, you know, we'll all figure it out. Thank you.
I try to score points sometimes, move around. Everything he did was, you know, looking to just crush you, looking to break you. So, that's how I feel right now. When I'm happy it's over with. I'm glad to get him past. You know, it's a tournament. I grew up doing tournaments, and one of the things about it is you gotta advance any way you can, and you know, and then hanging in there and being durable. We got alternates lined up for that very reason. But I think if Rampage and I got lucky anywhere, it was that we gotta go first. So we'll have the most recovery.
Nice. You made it clear, you know, takedowns were going to win you this fight, and it did. But in the first round, you were having quite a bit of success on the feet, landing the left hand a little bit, faking the takedown. I'm curious, was that always your strategy? Did you think you would be able to strike them a little bit, or did that just kind of happen on the fly?
I don't know if I ever thought about it too much, but I was trying to punch my way in and get close to where the other guy's at and set him up. I've had fights before where I can't take the guy down, so yeah, I work on that stuff every day. I had dreams in 2000 of being an Olympian for boxing. I never talked about it. I ended up pursuing wrestling, but I've been boxing. I think I've boxed more than any of these guys have. I don't know that they've ever competitively boxed. I used to competitively box, so you know, it's definitely plan B for me, but
and they'll have the box. And last thing for me, Jay, maybe kind of a funny question since you're victorious tonight, but knowing how tough it was and, you know, knowing, as you said, how strong and powerful it was, does it give you any pause at all to think that, you know, the guy that's coming out of the next side of your bracket is going to be a true heavyweight?
Oh, yeah, I got to get better. I got to get better for sure. I got to make some changes. I didn't fully know what I was getting into tonight. I got some sparring partners that are big, but, you know, they're not as good as Rampage. They're not as strong as Rampage. And, so I learned a lot in there tonight. And, now I gotta get better. I gotta make some changes. I don't know that I'll try to get stronger, but some of my movements gotta be different. Some angles gotta be different. But I didn't know how else to do it. I had to jump in there. Right, the name was set. The contract was signed. So yes, to answer your question, yes, I gotta improve.
Joe, I'm curious. When did you add that oblique kick to the knee into your arsenal? I never saw that from you before, but you were going right after Rampage's knee in the first round.
I saw John Jones had done that to him. John's a little longer than me, but that's kind of where I got that idea. And I was just trying to get close. You know, we had some separation in that fight, but it was kind of hard to close that distance. Every time I stepped in, he was throwing something really hard, and I was trying to lead with a jab, which isn't as powerful. I was just trying to kind of figure myself out in there.
He was attacking your body pretty severely. It looked like you had a lot of redness on your torso. Can you compare Rampage's power to someone else? I mean, who is the next most powerful guy you've ever felt punches like that?
You know what? Elie Seckbach actually hit really hard too. He would be second. Rampage would be one. He hit me somewhere in that fight after the round at the body, and I went, he heard that, and he just dropped his hands and he must have hit me 10 more times. But there's nothing I can do. It's a natural reaction when you get hit, right? It doesn't matter if you're a prize fighter or just a regular guy. It's very natural. So I think I tipped him off a little bit there. I didn't have much of a poker face and I paid for him.
And we know that you and Rampage had a little bit of a bet going into this one. How do you go about collecting that $30,000? Are you going to wait for him by the door? Is he going to mail you a check? What's the deal?
I'll tell you this. We'll see if he's a man of honor. We did shake on that. But... I'll tell you the other side, I will not cash this check. But I do expect him to hand me one. But what I do with it is my business. But I'll tell you, I will not cash that check.
Chael, so for most of the leading up to the fight, you were both very cordial, but it seemed like at the weigh-ins, and really tonight as you guys were going through the national anthem, the heat was kind of turned on a bit. Did that surprise you, considering just how things went leading up to it?
I don't know if I'd use the word surprise, but I mean, this is competition, and I would never try to sell anything. I didn't have heat with Rampage. We did the press tour together. He was a real gentleman. I think he thought the same thing about me, and I wouldn't try to make-believe anything or pull it over the fans' eyes or the media's eyes or Rampage's eyes. But when he steps in there, the first chance I get to put a knife in his back, I'm going to do it, and I trust that he knew that about me. And, you know, as he made that walk, it was game on, and the rules are the rules, and we'll operate within the rules, but there's not a whole lot of it.
And then also there's been some talk that the first round was more competitive. I want to ask, how did you feel after the first frame in terms of his striking compared to yours? And did you feel very secure in that round when you went to the stool?
I don't really remember the fight very well. I don't remember any of my fights very well. I got to go back and watch them. But I felt like it was a really hard fight. And I felt like, finding that range was really important because I stepped in it a couple of times. I got too close and he hit really hard. Whether you could see it or not, I'll tell you, he just hit really hard. So I was trying to find out where to be and it was a bit of a process. I kind of needed all three rounds to do it, quite frankly. I'm still not, if I was in there with him right now, maybe I'd have it figured out by now.
Chael, I've said a lot this week, taking the mickey out of you. Fantastic performance tonight against he was up for it, he was ready, and even, do you remember the body slam?
I remember the body slam. Gareth, he let me up. I couldn't believe he let me up. I was stuck underneath him, I was just getting ready to scramble, and I thought he was coming over the top, and he stood back and let me up, and I, thank you, okay, let's go up, but I thought that was a mistake by him. I think he had some real opportunity there.
There was a great atmosphere about the other six heavyweights parading in and the national anthem and you guys coming in. Did it mean a lot to you tonight? Because there was a sense of, the birth of Paramount Network, Ballator on Paramount Network. And did you have a great feeling when you walked in there, when you were part of that tonight with all the other guys in there. It was a big moment for the organization.
Yeah, just as a whole. I mean, and first off, I will tell you guys, I told you so. I told you guys about Lima. I warned you about him. I told him you were overlooking him. Look, if you knock down Rory McDonald, you're in a rare club. If you win a round against Rory McDonald, you're in a rare club. If you can go 25 minutes with Rory McDonald, you are in a rare club. Lima is that good. You know, whether he's the world champion or now he falls back to the number one contender, he's that good. And I don't feel like I have to convince anybody about Rory, man. That guy's something special. He's a one-legged man in an ass-whipping contest. He takes an entire round off, comes back, somehow regroups and finds a way to win. It was an inspiring performance. You know, they look at the card. I believe Michael Chandler is the best fighter we have in the contract. Move for move, skill for skill. Aaron Pico's the scariest teenager to ever get in the ring. It was just an awesome night. You know, my own teammate Bamba went out there and fought his heart out. I thought that Hoist's son, I thought that he got some great experience, you know. Did a great job by his opponent, but I thought he did a good job too, and maybe learned a couple of things. It was just a really good night. For me, and that's as a fan. I'm speaking as a fan, I loved it.
Jay, over here. With each takedown, were you counting how much money you were winning at the end of the night? Was it just tallying up with you?
No, I never thought about it. I never knew how serious to take it, but it did feel good to get it down. I was trying to pass his guard. I had a hard time passing. It was very strong. Went for a can opener. I tugged on that big neck of his. It didn't budge an inch. You know, he's a really powerful guy. I put two arms on one of his. I had it locked out. I couldn't budge it. It was like an iron pipe. He was a strong guy.
And what did he say? What did you guys say to each other after the fight? What's like you guys were?
He was very nice. He said, "Good job." He said, "You have a great game plan." And he said, "You surprised me with the boxing." I said, "Thank you."
Yeah, it seemed after the first round that Rampage was getting tired. Did you feel him getting tired at all after the first round?
I could hear him breathing a little bit. I didn't notice that it really slowed him down. But I had a big problem in that fight finding my range. I was talking about that earlier. But I had a big problem engaging and getting in there. I was circling a little bit. I knew he couldn't reach me, but when I wanted to come in and reach him, he was a little far out, and it was just a little bit tough. And that's my comment.
And after the fight, people were, you know, booing you in the arena, and you being a heel, did you embrace the hate before you in the arena?
No, I didn't know they booed. Did they boo something? I didn't know that. I was listening for the boos, and I didn't get them. I was disappointed. I even asked my sister afterwards. I said, "What was that crowd tonight?" I couldn't hear him, but. Good. Thank you. Thanks, guys.